Mr. David. You know, somebody has got to put the record straight, sir, coldly and fearlessly.
It dawns on me, our problem as a black people, our problem in this so-called revolution that is actually not being televised. What we are doing, the reason we are missing the point is that we are living as if though nothing is happening. Like we're looking at the election, I see black women, I see black men, black youth discussing who's going to be the next president. So here they are, tied into the hype, tied into the propaganda. And I try to show example. I try to show people the enigma or the phenomena, however you might look at it, that's happening next year during the Hebraic Feast of Trumpets. We go to Revelations 12, where it talks about the sun-clad woman, where the virgin will be giving birth to the messenger. In Revelations 12, the woman with 12 stars upon her head and all this type thing. I'm going to try to find it here in the book of Revelations and read it to you briefly, which is very apropos at this time that we pay some attention to. We have, okay, Revelation 14 and Revelations 12 I'm looking for here. It says, now a great sign appeared in the heavens. A woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. Then being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 diadems on his head. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them in the earth. So Revelations 12 corresponds or resonates with September 23rd, 2017, which is a few days away, which is next year. Okay, first, on the 8th, we'll have these elections. Things are going to change in a very subtle way, might even appear drastic. But what you need to observe is that corresponding with Revelation 12, on the 23rd, around that time, from the 20th to the 23rd, Virgo, now we're talking about the virgin, the sun-clad woman in Revelations 12. So visibly in the sky, the constellation Virgo, and this hadn't happened since 7,000 years. We've never seen it on flat plane Earth. We've never seen it on dome Earth. We've never seen it before, and you never will see it again. So this is a phenomenal event. We're around here looking at 12 years of slave, and we're around here looking at the birth of a nation, which is actually the same title as a silent Klan movie that came out, I think, in the 1940s, called A Birth of a Nation, where black people were being killed by the Ku Kluxers. So a brother that's accused of rape, have plundered and pillaging like the Klan, comes out with a black movie about the life of Nat Turner, where Nat Turner doing this revolutionary thing. And here's a phenomenal thing. The election is coming up, so we have the distractions. So next year, doing the Feast of Trumpets, the Hebraic Feast of Trumpets, which is also symbolic, we have Virgo will appear. And it says in the book of Revelations that this woman will have 12 stars in her crown, 12-starred crown. So you don't have 10. Let me see what she says. She said, the great sign appeared in the heavens, a woman clothed with the sun. Okay, the sun will be highlighting Virgo, with the moon on her feet. Virgo's feet will actually be on the moon. the constellation Virgo, feet will be standing over the moon, and she will have on her head a garland of 12 stars. So the constellation Virgo will actually, literally, have 12 stars above her head in the constellation of Regulus or Leo, one of those. But anyway, Virgo will be visibly in the sky, depicting or corresponding or resonating with chapter 12 in your Holy Bible. Now, note Virgo, Mary, same thing. And as I have said in my videos many a time before this, that the District of Columbia, the symbol of the District of Columbia, used to be a feminine symbol. Columbia was a feminine symbol. That same symbol is atop now of the, what's that building there? The Capitol building, I think it is. There's a Indian woman standing atop the Capitol building. That was Columbia. That was a symbol. Not only that, which actually represent Virgo, but there it that building represents the Sphinx. You can find this information in my book, The Holy Book of Wonder. You go on internet, any search engine, put in Holy Book of Wonder, Ital Iman, and you will find this. But in the District of Columbia, laid out by Brother Benjamin Banneker, that information is also in the Holy Book of Wonder. Banneker did it himself. Okay, look. Virgo is greatly symbolic in the District of Columbia. There are a lot of monuments there hidden out, basically esoterically, occultly, placed in certain places. Virgo, the destiny of this country is based upon what is fixing to happen next year. The Nation of Islam, I've told you the story also, where Farrakhan in the year 1988, there was a thing called the overwhelming debate where it's during the time, the overwhelming event, i.e., during the time of the debate of Jesse Jackson and Dukakis, the theme was called To Wanna Brawl, which is a play on the word, the name To Wanna Brawley, Dukakis and Jackson. And at that time, To Wanna Brawley was raped, it was said in the medias of that time, by six white men who defecated in a bag, a trash bag, and put her in there and laid her on some steps, and Farrakhan and Tanetta Muhammad came down, so to speak, and cleaned her up, brought her into the temple. Tanetta made a dress, a white pristine dress called Code 19. Farrakhan named To Wanna Brawley Miriam. That's Mary in Arabic. So the Nation of Islam is tied into this esoteric, this occult event that's happening next year. So why did Farrakhan do that? I also told a story where they was dedicating the temple that Elijah Muhammad had lost, and they had repurchased it, a Greco-Roman style temple, and they rededicated the temple, and Farrakhan named To Wanna Brawley Miriam, and he also named Elijah Muhammad's temple Mary. So we see Virgo and Mary here tied into the Nation of Islam from the esoterica. And to understand what I'm saying, note that Tanetta Muhammad, last wife of Elijah Muhammad, always did a column, and she taught on the esoterics of the Code 19. Now, staying with the Nation of Islam, we'll go over to Atlanta, Georgia, Camelton Road. There's a temple there ran by Brother Silas Muhammad. And in that temple, which is a Greco-Roman style temple, or a temple that looks sort of like the Egyptian temples, which America does it on the Greco-Roman style with the Egyptian symbolism. In that temple, they call the Honorable Elijah Muhammad what? They call the Honorable Elijah Muhammad Mother Mary. So why do they call Elijah Muhammad Mother Mary at Silas Muhammad's temple? So you see in the Nation of Islam, this esoteric thing where they're tied into the destiny of America. In Wallace Muhammad, son of Elijah Muhammad's book called The Light of Egypt, it's called As the Light Shineth from the East. It states that Dr. Farhad Muhammad gave the Nation of Islam a 60-year time to teach their message, to deliver their message. 60 years symbolic of the 6,000 years of the rule of the Aduma, or the rule of the white man, or the rule of the British powers, or the rule of the Illuminati. So next year, as according to the book that you Christians read, the Holy Bible, is the destiny, and this thing didn't just start yesterday, it just didn't come up. It started in the year 2000 when Mercury, Venus, Mars, Saturn, and Jupiter, the five naked eye planets, aligned with orb ship Earth for the first time in 6,000 years. Okay, from the year 2000, we come on to the year 2012. The galactic alignment. So all this time, from the time the Ross, when the chunk of ice broke off at the Ross ice shelf, when the poles started shifting in the year 2000, then 2012, the galactic alignment, when everything became gay, when Obama passed the gay laws and all this kind of thing like that. And now we're coming into the year 2017, three strikes. You're out. You say, then nothing happened. No, you don't understand the esoterics of this thing. You're looking for the poles to shift and everything over all of a sudden. Then you say, well, Ike Tall didn't know what he was talking about when he said it was going to happen, or Zachariah Stitchens, or with Richard Noon, and the people that said these things going to happen didn't know what they were talking about. Yes, we did know what we were talking about. So here we're caught in something that most black people are not even aware of. Most black and white are not anybody's. Basically, nobody is aware of the destiny of America. So that's why they're doing all this stuff that they're doing, because they know that their destiny is tied into next year. Now, what's going to happen? If in 2012 everything became gay, and then we see Hillary now running for president, looking like an old bobblehead, you know, she. And then you see Trump, same old bobblehead. So do you actually think that this country is going to be ran by some fools like that? It doesn't even make any sense. But the problem is that you people out there are going on every day like there's nothing happening. And there's this thing about ignorance that we have. I mean, I'm presenting something called the Mastery Blaster Jam. I've been doing it for 30-something years now. And I have a plethora of information on YouTube. I have a plethora of information on my blog page. And I present the Mastery Blaster Jam, and it's like everybody's caught in a freeze frame. It's like it's too much for them to perceive. But I found out that we're very shallow people, and we're fundamentalists. You know, we don't understand that the Bible is astrotheology, and the script is like allegory, metaphors, and similes. So we have to go beyond, what's that movie Tariq came out with? Hidden Colors 2 and 3 and 4 and all that. We need to go beyond Hidden Colors. And this movie, Birth of a Nation, need to be the last slave movie ever made. Yes, the movie, esoterically, the movie has some serious message there, but nobody's going to uprise. It's just like it's foolish for us to uprise, and it's foolish, doubly foolish, for the government to think that they can inspire black people to get up and try to overthrow the government. Overthrow what? A bunch of faggots? There's nothing to overthrow. Babylon was destined to fall, and it's fallen. All you got to do is, like in the martial arts, just step aside. And I'll just let the wind of your hand and your feet, just let it fall. Like Stevie Wonder said from the album Hotter Than July, the song Master Blaster Jamming, they want us to join the fighting. But our answer today is to let all of our worry like a breeze through our fingers slip away. Don't go out there fighting in a Black Lives Matter, which is a contrived event to cause anarchy, that they round your asses up and put you in prison. You know, just let it fall. It's going to fall. It was designed to fall. And in the architectural structures of our nation's capital, our destiny, our survival was written by our sagely brother, our sagely Masonic brother, Benjamin Banneker. They try to say LaFont and this man and that man laid the the blueprints and all this story. The real story is in the Holy Book of Wonder. Read the real story. Benjamin Banneker set up the blueprint for our freedom. It's right there in the nation's capital. Why do you think Martin Luther King, when he went there, he stood in a certain spot right before the Lincoln Monument? This whole thing is laid out, and the vibration is serious. Stevie Wonder said from the song Master Blaster Jamming of Sirius, when you're moving in the positive, your destination is the brightest star, which is the Egyptian dog star, Sirius. Okay, Ben Stone, you know, this thing is real. And I'm going to let you listen to our brother Mukhtar, our brother over there in South Africa, the South African sage. We'll let you know a little bit about our history and a little bit about what's going down. I'm just trying to pack all this in here because I know people don't like to look at videos, especially when it's a monotone like mine. You got to be out there acting crazy like some of the people out there that's delivering you that rhetoric. You don't like to listen to sound right reasoning. You have to put a little curse word in there, have to say a little MF and all that in there to get everybody excited. But we're not going to do that. So that should be our last slave movie. The government, maybe they shouldn't even allow it to come out. They allowed it to come out, so censorship is a reality. Censorship is a reality, so they allow that to come out. So they were wrong for doing that, trying to excite a riot. We don't want to do that. We don't want to do that. You're gonna fall anyway. So what they're trying to do is bring everybody down with them. Okay. We are chosen people, like Nat Turner showed, that little three little bumps on his chest there. You know, Sirius A, Sirius B, and Sirius C, three stars in the belt of Orion. You know, it's a prophecy, but Nat Turner has laid the foundation. You know, that happened for a specific reason. So we don't have to do that anymore. Our ancestors have shed enough blood for us. So the blood is out there. All we got to do now is beat the drum and sound the horn. The blood has been spilled, and we can go on with the ritual, sound the music, and the ancestors will come to our aid. And we're not talking about Oshun and Ogun spirits. We're talking about Enki and Enlil and Anu and Inanna. We're talking about real beings that will come to our aid. You are now in tune on the one, the force itself. At this time, we call it the Holy Master Blaster Jamming. And this is the wisdom of the Rastafari Mystery School. I am your brother, the Rastafari, Itol, Iman I. Yes, I am.
We black people, we were the mothers of the Sumerian civilization. There is not a single word in Sumerian but has an exact equivalent in Africa. There is not a single word in ancient Egyptians but has an exact parallel in Africa. We came, and for example, They call the South. Zakaria Sitkimse repeatedly refers to the southern part of the world as the Abzu. And the truth, the right pronunciation is not Abzu as in animal zoo. No, it's Abzu. They pronounced the Z-U as tzu. And that is an African word. If we say this person is very dark-skinned, we say umnyama tzu. But what? Mm-hmm. someone I'm looking for. Look, sir. Look at this. Mr. Tellinger says one of the many stone walls that still stand close to 3 meters high. A section of a large ruin with a diameter of 150 meters. A carved stone that resembles a human head stands close by as if it was part of some kind of ritual. Of course it was. That this is Anu, the great father of the human race. And he's right here in South Africa.
So let's take this in kind of a sequence then, Cradle.
Yes, sir.
You say the star people landed in Africa.
Yes, sir.
They started the mines and got the...
They enslaved the black people whom they found there.
And it seems that that place on the border of Botswana, the Toledo Hills?
Todilo.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
That was the place where humanity as we know it was seeded?
Yes, sir. Humanity landed there, directed by the great giant Todilo, the place of emerging of living animals.
And from there,
yes,
the
sir.
Knowledge and the myths and the beliefs and the language went north and eventually to Sumer and Egypt and became the base of those civilizations.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, please look at this. Doctor, listen to this. We read that the Sumerian deity Dumuzi was buried in the deep Abutsu on the edge of a cliff on top of a mountain facing east at his father's special place. This may yet become one of the most important historical discoveries that links human prehistory and so-called mythology of the 21st century. Listen to this. His father was the Sumerian deity Enki. Bullshit. Rubbish. Gag.
What is it?
Say. Enki is known in Africa as Nkai or Ngai.
For people that have not, you know, studied this, there's in the Sumerian tablets, Enki and Enlil are supposed to be the brothers who were leaders of a star people, shall we say, which
yes,
go
yes.
with the name in some cultures anyway, the Anunnaki, and that was all. It's all based in Sumer, but you're saying we have to come to Africa to find out.
Please, we have to, Mr. David. We have to. At one time, I was hoping to work with scientists like Madam Brenda Sullivan. Every god was ever worshipped by the Sumerians. Every god had his origin here in Africa. His or her name was African. Let me tell you about the goddess Inanna. In the fables of the Botswana people, in the fables of all tribes in East Africa and South Africa, the name Inanna occurs again and again and again. Not only that, in Africa, all the gods which were worshipped in Africa, which were worshipped in Sumeria, were actually African gods.
The same with Egypt.
Yes, sir. Ra, even today, amongst the Botswana people here, the name Ra means father. And the oldest warlike goddess was in Egypt, Hathor. In South Africa, she was known as Mahato, the mother of the great footprint.
Is that the footprint that you showed me once?
Yes, sir.
It's about 6 foot long, isn't it?
Yes, sir. And Mr. David, that footprint is the footprint of a woman, not a man. How do we know? If you are a tracker of people, you will notice that the instep of a woman's foot is slightly different from that of a male foot. Africa gave the world its civilization.
You were telling a story earlier, and I kind of give a bit of historical context about, you were telling a story about Enki and the relation of that figure to Africa. Could you continue with that story?
Yes, sir. Enki in Africa is known as Nkai or Ngai. He is still worshipped even now amongst the people of Kenya. And there is another god, a deity called Uru Wantai. Uru means old in or grand or majestic. Uru. And in Africa, you go to Zimbabwe, say, in Africa, the word for great is Kuru, and in Zululand, Kulu. The word Kuru or Kulu also refers to a grandmother. And here is another thing talking about grandmothers. A grandmother is called Gogo in Zulu. This immediately, say, joins African language to Greek language. The word Gogo means wise, old, leading person. And the word occurs also in Greece as Gogos. Gogos means a leader. From this comes the English word gog, as pedagogue.
Do you have the equivalent of Enlil, the Sumerian?
Yes.
The brother of
Enki. Yes.
And are they connected as brothers in African?
Yes, they are, Mr. David. They are. If you, the word Enlil means Lord of the voice, Lord of the command. And in the language of the Xhosa, to issue a call, to shout or to cry out is Lila. Immediately you are talking Sumerian, Lila. To wail as at a funeral is Lila.
Interesting, I talked to you over the years about your travels and how you found that you can understand people in apparently different languages all over the world, whether it's the Hopi or Australia. And are you saying that there was once one universal language, or at least a new language was introduced by the Star People, and it went out from Africa and changed slightly?
Yes.
That's why you can still understand
this
it.
Is what I'm saying, and I'm saying that defiantly, because it is true. And Lila means to cry out. En means king, and Lil means a shout or a voice shouting. So if a man, a god is called En Lil, it means the Lord of the commanding voice. And Enlil had a wife. Her name, wait for this, was Nina Lil. Nina means a female. And in Africa, even now, go to Zululand, what is the name for a mother in Zululand? Nina, N-I-N-A, Nina. If I say the mother of David, I say Unina ka Davida. The word Nina is the name of a female entity.
I've also read, Kralo, that genetic research has suggested, at least one study, that all of humanity can be traced back to a single female in Africa about 200,000 years ago, something like that. Does that fit with what you come across?
Yes, sir. I had the great friend, Professor Raymond Dart. And with him, we studied these things. He gave me the original words, and I could find similarities in Africa.
So you think that humanity was seeded in Africa and then went out from Africa? That's
yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, Mr. David. Otherwise, why are there so many hundreds of Indo-European words in the African language even now? Why are there words in the Indian language which are similar to African words? Take for example, say, in the Hindu language.
Excuse me, could you turn the radio down, please? Could you turn the radio down?
They
can't hear you.
No, so they can't.
Okay, doesn't matter. This is getting noise in the background.
We can go
to yeah.
into the temple, sir.
And we can go through this.
What I don't want to do is to disturb your train of thought.
No, it's quite all right, sir.
You're not going to lose anything, huh?
No.
I'll ask questions that would go before this. We can just cut to the mix to this. And then I'll throw some.
This is amazing, see, because Michael Tellinger's interpretations of what's happening in South Africa are going out all over the world. And it seems like no one is hearing your voice. And what I don't understand is, I know that you've met with Tellinger. Did he not listen to you, or did he not answer the right question?
He just used me, as they all do. I am the most used nigger in South Africa.
Did you tell him, Kralo, the sort of things you just told us?
Yes. Now, this man here, there's something here. This man here, he rejected me out of hand in the days when I was working with Brenda Sullivan.
Which man are you referring to? When you say this man here?
Romnik. Romnik. There is a white man who is called Romnik. He is a Hungarian. And if ever there was a man who is a bloody racist, it's him. He says that black people have no native intellect, that we all imitate what white people say. This is bullshit. Wait, I will find him. Let's go in.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's go inside and start doing.
Let me carry you back.
Yeah, I'm sure.
So, no problem.
No.
There you go. You give me those books, mate, and you just look after that. I'll take those.
Please. Sorry, mate.
Okay. Let's go.
I feel bloody weak, but that's my fault.
When you said, Credo, that.
Yes,
when sir. You said that you would like to set the record straight, then this is what we would like to help you to do, of course.
So
you're starting to do this now.
White people, even now, many of them, do not understand that a black person is capable of clear thought. We are despised in a way that is our best defense. We are despised, looked down upon.
If there is a message that you wanted to give to Michael Tellinger now.
He won't listen. I won't even waste my time. Because nobody really wants to listen to the African. We are called apes, unthinking monkeys. But that is much to our advantage. Some of the greatest black leaders in African history often used to play stupid in order to protect themselves. The man who killed Shaka used to behave like an idiot. He used to wear his loinskin back to front and wrong side out. And Shaka despised him. It was exactly like Brutus, the one who really shoved it into Julius Caesar. The world has got to know before Africa is destroyed, as she is in the process of being destroyed. The world has got to know what we know.
Yes, I wish to clear some things up here. I guess this is a little synopsis. Speaking of the Nation of Islam, in the year 1988, the overwhelming event, what happened was in 1988, that was a time that Louis Farrakhan became a part of the system. Their time was actually up in the year 1990, as written in their book, by Wallace Muhammad as the light shining from the east. Dr. Farad Muhammad, the mystic, the Sufi mystic from Pakistan, said that their time was up in the year 1990, which was 60 years, which is symbolic of the 6,000 years of the rule of Satan, or the Aduma, the first genetically engineered beings, or the powers that sits on the European throne. The destiny of America and the nation of Islam is tied in symbolic. If you know the teachings, we're talking about the 6,000 years. So at the dedication of the Temple Mosque Miriam, Louis Farrakhan, in symbolic gesture, wore a British derby. Now, in christening the temple, you know, like they do the ships, they take a bottle of champagne and sling it out and crack it. So the symbolic christening of the temple was, there was a douse raised in the somewhere inside of Mosque Miriam, a raised douse, where it was a mechanism that had a button where you can turn on the light at the top. Farrakhan did not turn the light on. Khalid Muhammad turned the light on. And on top of the temple, Mosque Miriam, there's a crescent and star. There's a light there. So when they pushed that button, the light came on. That was a symbolic christening of the temple of Mosque Miriam. On Khalid Muhammad's finger, there was a star and a crescent ring, same as it was on top. As it is below, so is it above. Khalid Muhammad's finger was the one that turned the light on. Okay, Khalid Muhammad was soon demised, just like Malcolm X. So all this was symbolic. It was a ritual. Louis Farrakhan, with his British derby on and a British uniform, a British type suit clothing, was symbolic that he would be, that he is no longer who he was, or whoever he was supposed to be. He's now a part of the Allies. Surah 88, Holy Quran. Let's go to Surah 88 just briefly, you know. And I'm pretty sure I might be wrong, but Surah 88 is the Allies. I'm not sure yet. Let me check. No, it's called the overwhelming event. Something else happened. Oh, and when they had the Million Man March, that was the Allies, which was all about getting votes for George Bush back at the time. So all this thing is political. After 1990, the Nation of Islam was strictly working for the government incognito. So now that you see that he's over to Scientology, it's nothing strange, because the Nation of Islam vibration is gone. So it was 1988. It's called the Overwhelming Event. And that's the name of this chapter. And that's when the debate of Jesse Jackson was running for president against Dukakis. And that's when they had that little debate. And that's when the thing about Miriam went down. So this Mary and Miriam and all that is tied into the government. So that's how deep the Nation of Islam is. People don't believe that the Nation of Islam is very significant. The Nation of Islam is very significant, and the vibration is still functional. It's just a fact that in the year 1930, there were two redemption movements. It was the Nation of Islam and the Rastafari movement. The time limit of the Nation of Islam is over. Now it's the Rastafari movement. Thus, you're hearing this information, which is clearing all things up. And the clearing of all things up is in the book that's been written over a 36-year period of time come next year. It's called The Holy Book of Wonder. And as I said, you can order that book and get it now, and you'll know what's going down. You got a short period of time to do it. There was something else that I wanted to bring out, and it eludes me, and it's very important. Oh, we're talking about the Benben Stone, and a lot of you esoteric people out there and Egyptologists know about the Benben. But anyway, the African American Museum, and we're talking about the foundation that Benjamin Banneker laid for us. You can find that information in the book also, Holy Book of Wonder. the African American Museum of History, of Culture and History, the Smithsonian African American Museum of History and Culture was designed by a black architect from Africa. This, if you notice this building, it's like a, they say it's like a crown, it's shaped like a crown, three tiers on the top, but it goes underground also, just like the Great Pyramid. But in corresponding to the Washington Monument, which is an obelisk with the Benben stone on, symbolic Benben stone on the top of the phallic symbol, the museum is like a landing or upside down pyramid if you look at it close. So back in September, the grand opening was September 23rd and 24th, which corresponds to a year later, an event that would take place, the Revelation 12 I'm telling you about, the Feast of Trumpets. That day, at the grand opening of that museum, the African American Museum, was symbolic of an event that should take place next year. That vibration is a Sirius vibration. Number 23 is a resonant number of Sirius. And why did that happen? See, the white man plans a plan, Satan plans a plan, but Allah also plans a plan. For he is the best of planners. They didn't realize, or did they, that they were doing a, that was a rite, that was a black, called a black rite, a part of the Osirian mysteries, a part of the Orion mysteries. It's a part of the black mysteries, the black rite, where they had a concert on the 23rd, and on the 24th was the grand opening of the building. It just so happened he wasn't on the list to be there, but just happened that Stevie Wonder was there. So we see that the grand opening, all this information is written in the Holy Book of Wonder. This event foreshadowed or was a harbinger of an event that would be. In the museum, there's a mothership of George Clinton, plus all of our history since we've been here in the wilderness of North America. So the African Museum of History and Culture is very symbolic. It is a pyramidic shaped building, and it's actually the cornerstone of the Washington Mall. It was the last piece of land, the last spot on the mall for a building to go up. That particular pyramidic structure was laid there symbolically in the same tradition as esoteric symbol that you can only see from the air. Just like the Nazca line, you can only see it from the air. So if you go up in the air, you will see the occult layout designed by our brother, a black man, Benjamin Banneker, who brought us information about the Sirius star years, hundreds of years before the Dogon released their information to the white archaeologists and scientists in the 1930s. You are now in tune on the one, the force itself. At this time, we call it the Holy Master Blaster Jet.
South Africa. I live in the land where Adam's calendar is.
Yes, I've been there. I was initiated on top of that stone, which looks like a lion. Yes. As ugly as myself.
Right. Baba, I work with the wild horses. I work with the wild horses of Cops Work, the wild horses.
Yeah, Baba.
And my question to you, Baba, is I recently discovered, I don't know if the description is right, but stone gongs.
Yes.
Stones that make music.
Yes, sir.
Baba, this is my question to you. Can you tell me about stone gongs?
Yes. So, the whole incredible thing which goes right where you have been, where you come from, it goes right up, double rows of stones going right up the map into Somaliland. It was intended by our ancestresses and the ancestors to communicate with the Madons, the silent ones from the stars. The whole thing, right up from Swaziland, up the map to wherever it ends, it was a communication device from by human beings on earth to the entities in heaven. Say, there are those who don't know African people. They say we worship spirits. We don't. A thing from the stars, even taller than you are, would you say, sir, that it is a spirit? A thing that can smack a man like me with one club from here till next week, who is that the creature of my imagination? Africans were communicating with stellar entities since the day when Africa was born. There is a great mistake, Menier, that scientists are making. They tell you that Egypt was in North Africa. I speak Afrikaans nogal. Dit is nie so nie. Die land van Egypte was hier so in Suid-Afrika. Here in South Africa, there is a place in the Cape and in a part of Natal where you see all kinds of marks on flat stones. And when you look at these marks are made by boats.
Boats.
No?
I'm sorry, boats.
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 Boats. Oh.
Ships.
Ships.
Oh. The land of Egypt did not begin where fools say it is. The land of Egypt began right here in South Africa, in Natal. It is there where the holy stones were created. It is there where people, if they had some sense in their heads, would be talking with the real gods of heaven. Honorable Menier, our people did not imagine gods. Our people saw the gods, and they were not the so-called spacemen whom fools think they see today. They were as real as you and I are. And they told our ancestors and ancestresses how to create a civilization in South Africa. This thing, Honorable, you recognize what it is? It is a pharaoh's scepter. It, we dug it up in a cave here in South Africa. Thousands of years ago, our people spoke with the creatures from the stars. And we are told, we who try to follow the old way, that the ancestors from the stars are going to come again and pay us a visit before great changes occur in this planet. They are not imaginary creatures. They are as real as you and I are. They are not as ugly as the writers of science fiction would have you know. Some are even more beautiful than we are. There you are, honorable. It should be the Adama's calendar. Dahti Hohaki van Gistere was a fruit man's mayor. The place where the honorable gentleman has just spoken about is the holiest place in all Africa. It was there where our ancestors and ancestresses actually communicated with beings from beyond the stars. It was not a myth, it was not a fable, it was a fact. There we are. Thank you.
goodbye, love.